Hi, I wanted to thank everyone first for coming here today, and whether humans or pets, as in this case, that's awesome.
Thank you.
But today we're going to talk about sort of the legal issues that surround having your own brand, whether it's on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, you know, and just the associated things related to that. Obviously, I need to give this disclaimer first. Everything given here does not create an attorney-client relationship. It's all general legal advice. I have to do this because literally there are sometimes people who are like, oh, this lawyer told me to do this. I'm like, I did not tell you to do that. I told you about a general situation. Yeah. So I have to give the unfortunate legal disclaimer first, because otherwise it would be something given by a lawyer. It would be given by someone else. The first thing I want to talk about today is how many people here sort of stream on Twitch or stream with games already? Okay, cool. How many of you guys have like a business corporation set up for it? Okay, cool. I guess the other question is, how many of you guys have any other separate businesses, whether it's not streaming? What business is it?
Well, I do graphic design.
Okay. In the back, yours was?
Nonprofit
podcast. Okay, cool. Now, the thing that's important to remember of all of these is that even if it's nonprofit, the important thing is what's called having a business incorporation. And it doesn't mean you're necessarily a corporation, be a limited liability corporation. This is like, I tell people, the most important thing. It's one thing if you're developing a game on your own, you haven't shared it with anyone yet, and you don't have a corporate LLC, that's okay. You're keeping it to yourself. This is just private development on your own. But if you're going to have a business or have something where you are selling it, you need to have an LLC, a corporation, whichever structures are more appropriate for you. Keep in mind that, you know, I may say LLC, but I'm using that sort of a generic term, where if I say incorporation, it doesn't necessarily mean having a corporation set up. It varies, registration fees. For example, a corporation in New York, there's this really stupid old law in New York that you have to publish in a newspaper. And this is basically a scam by the newspapers to still get money. In Buffalo, it's not that expensive. And people sometimes try and creatively register in Buffalo, which isn't a good idea, to get around it. In New York, it's paying an extra $1,200 so the New York Times can publish your business announcement. Thankfully, in Pennsylvania, our state doesn't suck, so we don't have that. But it's something to keep in mind. If you're going to be selling something, you need to have an LLC or a corporation. Part of the reason is what's called personal liability. If you're operating as a general practitioner for yourself, or as a solo practitioner, or just without any structure, and especially if you're operating with other people, which is a nightmare because you have no relationship sort of put down in the contract or any form, means that if you get sued for something, you're on the hook for it. Now you're probably thinking, well, if my business gets sued, I'm on the hook for it too. Yeah, but the difference is they can't seize your property, your house, they can't attach it to your wages. Imagine getting sued because you screwed up a vendor deal and they attach your wages. So you're stuck working doing some minimum wage bullshit job and someone is getting a legal judgment collected off of the, what's it, $725 now? Mm-hmm. That you're getting for working at like a movie theater, cleaning out the bathrooms or something. It's an expense that you have to bear at the beginning. First of all, keep in mind the expenses you spend on setting up a business are generally tax deductible, or at least you can offset some of your taxes. Obviously, you talk with an accountant about that. I'm going to say that phrase a lot because while I know the principles, the nitty-gritty of the accounting is something you want to do with an accountant. I know some people like doing their own taxes, and depending on your knowledge base, that's okay. But I would always recommend getting an actual accountant you can interface with. Not necessarily the dude you rush into at, H&R Block. Yeah, H&R Block. I mean, I'm not saying those people aren't good, but I mean, someone who you can call during the off season and you know still exists and didn't just transition onto a different job. There's nothing wrong with doing that work, but they know how to apply taxes in the most efficient way. One thing you're gonna wanna do when you set up your LLC, if you set up an LLC, is what's called an IRS Form 2553, an election to be taxed as a S corporation. You don't become a corporation, you're still an LLC, it's just your income now is taxed at a different rate. And the way it's done is you can have some of your, the money you make taxed as salary and some taxed as profit. So you're taking profit out of dividends essentially from the company. You can't take it all out as profit as opposed to income because the IRS got very mad at people doing that or essentially saying, oh, I don't need a salary. I'm just taking it all out of profits and not paying that much tax. The IRS really didn't that's why you talk to an accountant. They know the appropriate amount. But for example, my wife here does a lot of freelance proofreading, editing, and I set her up an LLC and also for an S-Corp. We saved a decent amount of money because the S-Corp structure was there instead of just being taxed at a general rate as a regular LLC, and far better than if you'd just been like getting the checks yourself. Like I said, personal liability is something you want to avoid. You don't want to have to worry about, oh my God, I did this. What if my video, if somebody threatens me with a copyright suit? Because you still have to pay out of something. If you have an LLC, you can eventually throw your hands up and go, oh, got out the money. I guess I'm going bankrupt, but the company's going bankrupt. You're not going personally bankrupt yourself. That's a huge and important distinction. Obviously, there are certain regulations you have to follow because you can't make your company look like it's your personal piggy bank. There are certain formalities, and you know, that's something you've talked about another time. But just the things you have to do, whether if you're a corporation, having regular meetings, even if it's literally you sitting there voting on something, writing it down, and that's your meeting. It's still the proper format. Like I said, it's a cost at the start, but it's an important cost. If you're seriously intending to do something where you want to make a profit, you need it. And if you don't have the money yet to do it, then don't do the enterprise. Wait till you have the money. If for nothing else, you don't want your personal wages being attached at some time instead of a legal debt. It sucks. I can thankfully say that hasn't happened to me, but I've known people who've had that happen to one time. There was a guy who had for a debt that he didn't actually owe. It was just the guys doing it were idiots and didn't check his social security number correctly. And that was a huge pain for him, and he was pretty well off. It was more like an annoyance, like, why the hell is this happening to me? Imagine if this is, you know, cuts into a significant part of your rent. So I always say, please just incorporate beforehand. Whatever the structure is, you should also make an S-Corp election if you're an LLC. Sometimes it doesn't make sense to make that if you set up as a corporation or some other sort of structures. But general LLC, it's just a better way for your taxes because generally it's just functioning as a pass-through. Instead of going to you, it goes to the company, and then you just, I mean, in my case, I just transfer the money from one account to the other instead, because there's no point in writing a check to yourself, then going to the bank to deposit when you're just transferring the same thing. You still have the records to show it. And that's always an important thing, is keep records. I mean, even if it makes you somewhat of a pack rat, still keep records. You never know when you're gonna need something. Yes?
Do you need the physical original record or the digital copy?
Digital's fine too, yeah. I'm just saying, most banks provide you copies anyway, digitally. I know PNC does, so it's not something you necessarily have to print out, store in a airtight or watertight container in the basement or in a bunker, but it's good to at least know where they are so you can easily access them. Another advantage when you get your LLC is, how many of you guys love handing out your social security number for forms you have to fill out? I mean, it's really fun, and I had the fun experience of someone stealing my social security number about 3 years ago. Probably some son of a bitch wanted to buy $250 worth of Star Wars The Old Republic get credits. I know why, because you can easily resell them on eBay because the cards they don't deactivate the cards. They also bought what was it, Jess? It was Baby Center and like some really skanky perfume.
And also like phones, right?
Oh yeah, no, the person bought Verizon, let a person walk out there with 3 iPhones and 4 iPads.
Yeah.
Same store.
Yeah.
That's not suspicious.
No, not at all. Well, there's in New Jersey. But also, like, it's a mess you don't want to deal with. Yeah.
But then, I mean, you know, even if they did steal your social security number, you're not responsible.
No, but you have to go track down all those things to have those accounts closed.
You have to go
through Experian, you have to go through TransUnion, there's another one, I don't even remember the name of it, to see what accounts were open, to make sure that the accounts are closed and that it's removed from your credit history.
Right.
Because sometimes these things will stay active. I had some stupid thing called Credit Karma run a passive check, and those don't even necessarily show up, but it's the point of the matter. They had like some executive who was also big in DJing, and I couldn't get any contact, so I started bugging him on Twitter, like, can you fix this? I'm like, I don't care if you're DJing now, fix this. Worked. Apparently annoying people on their personal Twitter. I won't say stalk somebody, but if you're in a situation where your credit's being screwed with, I don't care if they're spending some crappy EDM, you mess with them. In a totally legal manner, of course. Politely, but firm. But yeah, I mean, but the advantage is once you have an LCSF, and you don't necessarily need one to get a taxpayer ID number, but it's worth getting anyway, you get to give people a taxpayer identification number. You know what that means? You don't have to give the dude with the creepy Battlestar Galactica shirt or something your social security number because you want to set up a booth somewhere. You don't have to wonder why he writes it down and sticks into a pile of just God knows what. I mean, you can still get screwed with a looting taxpayer identification number, but at least you're not going to have some dude opening up Walmart, Best Buy. Man, someone really at loves Synchronicity credit cards.
They're so easy to get.
Yeah. And the funniest thing was, you know who I have to thank for telling me? T-Mobile. Because they actually turned the guy down, whoever it was. Verizon had no problem. And the worst part, were bills were showing up at my old address. And we didn't have mail forwarding service because it's been like a year or two. So it's an even bigger problem. So that's just another thing you can avoid. So if you're ready to do something professionally, get an LLC set up. Get the S-Corp election made if it's appropriate. And definitely get a taxpayer identification number because, as I said, identity theft sucks and it's not fun to deal with. Especially, yeah?
What would the LLC be? I don't know if I missed
that. Oh, Limited Liability Corporation. It's just one of the many structures. Some people have corporations. There are a couple of other ones, but usually LLC or corporation are the two big ones. Yes?
Our son set up an LLC for his gaming thing through LegalZoom.
LegalZoom?
$100 they did everything.
LegalZoom kind of sucks, and I'll just be honest with you, because LegalZoom is a legal form service. They don't have people check it. They offer a service where they'll make sure you spelled your name right throughout the document.
Well, apparently, they did the name check to make sure it'll come with that name. All that. They do the basic preliminaries.
Right. I mean, like but that's something literally the attorney does or someone else. They don't check to make sure you're checking a structure that makes sense to you. Even if they get your taxpayer identification number, some of them do it, but some don't necessarily do the forms correctly. And it's just like going to a Staples. I don't know if they still sell them, but they used to sell like legal forms, packets of them. It's essentially that's the service. And another thing is to have an operating agreement set up. They'll give you one that's just literally been used 100 times that has necessarily may not apply to you in the least. It's just a form, they fill your name in. I've had people who've tried doing trademarks or wills through. And it doesn't meet their needs necessarily because it's one size fits everyone on the planet with no sort of variation. And obviously, LegalZoom is a competitor for me, so obviously I'm going to trash talk it a little, but that is just one of the problems with legal forms is that it's a form, they're filling the form out for you, and you're filling the form out. They're not filling it out. You're typing it in the computer and they put it in the form and send it away. I mean, that's it. You don't get any feedback saying, you know, is this the right way to go? Is this structured? Do they make the S-Corp election? Do they get the ID? Like all this other stuff. So that's why I think LegalZoom doesn't, it's just, you don't have that someone looking over because if a lawyer commits malpractice, you sue him for malpractice. If LegalZoom screws up, that's it. They don't have that sort of, there's not that sort of personal risk involved with them.
So for, you know, corporations, LLCs, get that limited liability shield, you have to, you know, file with the state. You also have to renew every year. What other things do people need to do to keep up your...
Funny enough, you don't necessarily... Renewal rates, actively renewing kinds of varies depending on the state. Like in some states for the S-Corp election in New York, you have to make it both at the state level and the federal level. Because, you know, it's New York and they have to duplicate everything. Pennsylvania, you don't have to do that. It's just for the federal level. But the fees usually aren't high. Some places there are an annual fee. Like I know Massachusetts, it's actually cheaper to have a corporation than a LLC because it's like a $500 a year fee.
Yeah, they have like a franchise.
Yeah, it depends. Pennsylvania does not. I'm trying to remember New York offhand. But it's one of those things that varies from state to state. And that's one of the, going back to sort of the LegalZoom thing, is they don't necessarily say, make sure you have your franchise tax paid or you need to set this amount aside. Right. And that's one of the things you want to know is like, well, do I have to set this much? You don't want to be April 15th, like, well, you need to pay $1,000 if you file beforehand.
Right. So besides whatever annual thing, is there anything else that people should know to avoid their entity from, you know, getting dissolved?
It varies on the state from state. That's, you should always check with the, it's usually the state, Department of State or Department of Corporations in another state. Just check with them, the annual regulations, like, and actually, because you can find out sort of benefits. Like in Pennsylvania, if you're a veteran or retired military, they waive the fees. They have something that literally only started this year, which is great, but it sucks because I have a client who set up a year before and it would have applied to him, and I remember telling him about it. I was like, oh God, they just passed this, and he was like, ah. But he's a wonderful, great client. But it sucks when you can't really, you can't go back retroactively, and it's like, Pennsylvania, please give me my money back. Pennsylvania's not giving me money back. But sort of the next step, sort of focusing on that. So we said, you know, really, before you do anything, if you're intending to profit from, set up the LLC. The next thing is checking the name you want to use. Obviously, there's seeing whether the name is registered with the state for a previous business entity. But you have to keep in mind, the name of your LLC doesn't necessarily mean the name you're going to use. LLCs can sometimes have sort of quirky, goofy names. They can be pet nicknames. They may be mentioned somewhere, like, you know, when you're listing which owns what. But just because, say, for example, I'm just picking a name out of a hat. AVGN doesn't necessarily have an LLC that says AVGN. I believe his is Cinema Massacre. So it doesn't necessarily have to be the name you're using. That's not the same as like trademark. You want to make sure that no one else is using it. I would like jokingly say, you may really think the name 420 COD Weed Killer Machine is a great name, but there's a chance someone else might have that. So before you start branding or designing things, check to see if the name's out there. And if it is, walk away. You may be like, damn, no, my idea is better. It's going to get more attention. Don't. You don't want to have someone out there as something similar to you, because first of all, they're going to drain away your views. And if their channel sucks and someone misspells it, they're going to go to the crap channel instead of yours. So you don't want to bleed off subscribers or viewers because of that. Yes?
Is there like a really quick, efficient way to check if your name is being used out there?
Well, depending on the platform you're going to use. Like if you're using, say you only want to use Twitch. Mm-hmm. I know there's some people who moved away from YouTube or recently. So search through Twitch, see what channels there are. Even if it's a dead channel, it's frustrating. I mean, you can always attempt to contact the person to buy it from them. But then if somebody gets something like that, A, they're going to think it's a scam. And B, they're going to suddenly think they have, like, you know, a pound of gold or something.
Yeah.
It's not going to be worth it.
Yeah.
But what you need, yep.
Would Social Blade work as a way to, like, look up names and whatnot people thinking?
It's one way. I would think, I always say you look up as many different ways as you can, because it's not how many searches you do, it's the one where you find the one that didn't show up in the other ones. So I would say always go through like the actual platforms you want to use, anything that sort of does scraping off social media sites. And the thing is, just to know that, I believe Trent Reznor said they went with the name Nine Inch Nails because it's the only thing that they could stick with for 3 days that they thought was okay. It's okay to change your name. That's why you pick your name before you do any branding or design stuff, because I know it's all about, no one wants to see a YouTube channel where it's just a picture of a guy. I have a YouTube channel like that myself. I've done like 3 videos on it, just legal ones. And you know, it's an exciting 30 subscribers and about 100 views. I think I only got, one video does have about 1,200 views, and that's because one of my clients, James Roth, was kind enough to tweet it out to people, so.
That's the only reason.
But yes, that's the thing. You need to make sure that you're gonna want a logo. And actually that goes to the next thing. Sort of clearances. Oh, you really love the way, I hate to be picking up just because it's an actual logo, the Doom logo. That would look cool. What if I do my name in that font or something like that? Well, Bethesda may not care if it's just the font, but sometimes fonts can be copyrighted or trademarked depending on how it's used. You don't necessarily want to run that problem. So it's best to always try and stick original as much as you can. If you use a software or something that allows you to design it, make sure that the rights in that software allow you to use any, like if it has a library or a clip art, but if it's something that allows you to use like, you know, different images, make sure they're royalty free, Shutterstock.
OpenOffice.
Yeah. But yeah, you always want to make sure that, because you want something that you can monetize the crap out of. You don't want something wondering like, if you have a friend do it, make the friend, and I know this sounds like the most asshole thing in the world to do, but I'm a lawyer, so I can say it. Have your friend sign a release making sure it's a work for hire and that they relinquish all rights to it. I know that sounds like, wow, what a wonderful, loving friend, but if you want to pay them for it, I mean, that's a cool thing to do too. Or if you want to say cut them down a profit market, a royalty rate later on, you can do that. But usually it's just a friend who's doing something as a one-time thing. You pay him, make it a work for hire, and you can use that logo. You want to make sure that there's no, like, someone who says, like, oh, I designed that, because the last thing you want to deal with is, let's see, what would the term be? Twitter/Reddit/other things bullshit drama. You don't want to deal with that crap. You don't want someone saying, oh, well, he took my logo, and then, you know, some, Reddit's a pain in the ass to actually look at on anything, just especially mobile, so. Like someone's upvoting, you're like, oh, they stole this guy's, so you don't want to deal with that crap. So it's always good to take that from the head.
So let's say you do like design an original logo in Photoshop. You don't use any clip art, you just you do your own line art, it's completely original. It's yours.
Yeah.
Now you put it on, let's say you put it like as your logo on your YouTube channel.
Yeah.
And then you come to find out, oh, someone stole it.
Well, here's where the thing you want to do is once you're, you know, because it's not an insignificant cost, but once you're sure you want to do something with that logo, trademark it.
Okay.
Trademark it ahead of time. Keep in mind, even if you're not actively using, you can file what's called a 2B intent to use versus 2A, which is you're already using. You have to pay like $100, $200 later on to show that you're using it, but it allows you to get first in line. Once you have a trademark, unlike, say, a copyright strike, trademark, there is sort of fair use, but not the same way it's codified with copyright. So if somebody's selling your stuff, you just send a C&D to them and say, take it down. You say, talk about the Lanham Act, trademark violation, or trademark infringement violations, and that stuff's gonna go. Like, I know Amazon's policies, they don't get involved in disputes like that. You send them that, they'll take it down, and guess what? The other person, they're just gonna say, we don't get involved in these disputes. Trademark is a very powerful sword to have. Copyright's also important too, obviously, though, with the way YouTube is, like, you're uploading videos every day, because if you don't upload every day, your subscriber count's getting screwed with, and whatever they do with that algorithm of theirs, which is part voodoo and part, like, being an asshole from what I've told you.
So something I always want to know is, what's the difference between trademark, copyright, and registered trademark?
Okay, that's actually easy. Copyright expresses an idea, a fixed format, so you can't just have this ephemeral idea for something copyrighted. If you write something down, it's copyrighted. Now, I should say there's a difference between copyrighted and a registered copyright.
Okay.
If you're gonna sue someone in federal court, that copyright has to be registered. And if you want attorney's fees, which are very important if you're suing someone for copyright infringement, attorney's fees, expenses, it has to be registered. Now, the problem is there's a timeline from when you publish it to when you can register it and still get the attorney's fees, the protection. You can still sue, but you don't get what's called statutory damages, damages fixed in the law itself, which are nice, but they're not as big as the other fees. The problem is that there is sort of an exception, like if you discover like infringement within a certain amount of time and register it, you can get around it, but you can only do it within a certain amount of time anyway, so it's only like, get the exact amount, but it's still always good to register something. Now keep in mind with YouTube, because I'll get back to the difference of trademark and registered trademark in a second. With YouTube, they don't require a copyright certificate necessarily, but you can always claim other videos. I mean, you need to prove ownership, but man, monetizing other people's videos is a beautiful thing. Because somebody likes your content, say if you have music, and then they upload it with some crappy like 3D animation, or like some second grade picture of Sonic, and it's just like,
gotta go fast.
Yeah. Gotta go fast, or it's like, remember Winamp and like those stupid bullshit? Like, I never used them because I was like, I'm not on LSD and I'm not high, so why the hell do I care about these things? The shapes are moving back and forth. No, I don't need that crap, but people love doing that. And then guess what? You get to claim their video and you get to monetize it. Rule of thumb is anything you monetize in the US gets the best rate. I think Europe too, most of Europe. Once you go over to Russia, China, India, the rate, I understand, decreases, but you're still getting money off. Because sometimes their videos that have been re-uploaded, they get like hundreds of thousands of views. And you don't have to be the ogre who's taking everything down. I mean, if it's real crap the way it's done, like say they like, I don't know who the hell sits and watches a movie where it's like partially cropped off, it's got these weird dots over it to defeat the image filter. I'm like, what type of like dystopic 1984 society is that being broadcast in? Where it's like, finally, you can watch Terminator dubbed in the Polish. And they have hundreds of thousands of views. I'm just like, it's one thing I get the small shrunken screen one, because I've seen that for, everyone knows the show Ancient Aliens. I forget his name. What's the name of the rapper? He had the show on. I think it was Vice TV or
Action Bronson.
Yeah, Action Bronson Travels the Stars, where it's just him getting really high with other people watching Ancient Aliens. And because I didn't have Vice, I'm like trying to find clips on YouTube. And you find people would upload episodes, and they're sort of like the business card size. That makes sense, I guess. But this other stuff that literally looks like you like glaucoma, and you need like pounds and pounds of weed or something shipped to you desperately. I don't understand how people view it, but they do, and it generates revenue. So that's something really important. Is the copyright registration important from the legal end of it, but for the YouTube end of it, my understanding, I may be wrong, isn't necessarily as important.
When something's royalty-free, is it royalty-free forever?
Depends on the way it was issued at the time. If somebody issued something under a royalty-free license, and you use it under the license at that time, it should be, but then they can always revoke it and say they're changing the terms of it. Now, there's questions of the validity of that, but one advantage is purchasing royalty-free music on your own, as opposed to like, what's the guy's name? The one everyone used on YouTube, not Kevin Cloud, that was the guy from Kevin McLeod. You know, it's that one video, like when everyone's stuff gets blanked for an audio claim, they replace it with one of this guy's tracks. That one's an example, but sometimes just purchasing stock music is useful. And there's tons of services. I mean, if you ever used to watch Kung Fu movies, Shaw Bros. Movies, they were filled with lots of stolen music, which is beautiful in its own way, but also stuff from the Wolf Company, which still exists. They produce what's called library music. You buy it from them, you get a permanent license for whatever the hell you want. So that's one thing to look into. As composing your own music too, but people's grants can always change, and while I think most courts would look favorably on the fact that they used it under the terms that they were granted, and you can't change and then try and attack them with it, it's still something you can avoid entirely in the first place. Now, the difference between a trademark and a registered trademark, going back to that, is the TM and the R in the circle.
Yeah.
A TM states your intent to trademark something, or that you view it as something trademarked, but you haven't registered it. You can often see it on certain video games, because keep in mind, you can't trademark, it's called the single title rule. You can't trademark a single game title. Now you're gonna say, what about Super Mario Brothers? Well, that's a series of titles. Once you produce more than one, you can trademark the series name. But you could do Uncharted by that point. Definitely do Uncharted, but the Drake's part, now you can trademark probably Drake as a character at this point, because he's been in numerous games, multiple forms of media, makes sense. If you notice, R2-D2's trademarked. I remember when they had Droid, the first ads coming out of Lance Hendrickson doing the voice, said Droid trademark license under license from Lucasfilm. So it's one thing to keep in mind. But a registered trademark is one that's registered with the United States Patent and Trademark Office, and you've been granted a trademark. It's a very important process, because like I said, look, we've been at cons, we see like, people love to do art. People love to do art of things they don't necessarily own the rights to. Look, I thought that picture, somebody had this bizarre picture the first day, and someone must have bought it because I could not find it because it's the funniest thing, I wish they took a picture, of Leon Kennedy sitting around in boxers with an RPG and his guns on it. It was the most bizarre thing ever. It was just like, this is hilarious. But I don't think the person did a licensing deal with Capcom to produce like scantily clad Leon Kennedy RPG hand-drawn photos. God bless him for being creative like that, but you know, that's kind of something to deal with too. Like, what if somebody starts making knockoff stuff of yours or putting your logo on something? That's one of the reasons it's trademarking. There are two separate types of trademark. Actually, more than two types, but the one of them is like called a sound trademark. Like, everyone remember the old NBC logo? That's actually registered as a trademark, the sound itself. It's pretty uncommon to happen. Most are generally what are called like the text ones, where it's just say, okay, for example.
Too many games?
Yeah, too many games, just the term, too many games. But say if they had a specific stylized font, too many games with just the font or the way it's drawn, there's one for that. The text one protects the term too many games, the other one protects the design. So one's sort of like design, the other's text. So if you have a logo that incorporates your name into it, I would always say go for the text one first, because say for some reason the text one has issues and it's held up, whether they consider it generic if it needs to be on the secondary list for like 5 years, or just for any other reason, but you get the logo. Well, that's great if somebody rips off the logo, but the text in the logo, You don't get like to use it twice. It's, so in this case, it would be the design of Too Many Games, but it wouldn't be Too Many Games. So that's why you should always go for the text one first, unless there's a compelling business reason, which it does occasionally happen, but usually, say it would be a licensing deal where they want to use a logo. But at that point, really, if you have the funds, do both. I mean, I'm saying that as a lawyer, so pay me twice to do it, but it's generally just the best way to do it. But if you have to be economical, go with the other one first. And sometimes design logos change over time. There are ones that if you look up in the USPTO's index are listed as dead because they're no longer used anymore. Businesses rebrand and change all the time. I think the famous one was some sort of syrup for pancakes, and it's changed over time. That one's changed a lot over time.
I know 7-Up used to be black and red.
Right. So, I mean, trademarks do change, and you still always try and maintain the old one, but you registered the new one, too. It's the same thing, and especially a case with, like, a major food brand. There's tons of knockoff crap all the time. So that's sort of, like, where copyright is, where trademark is. There's also patents, which I didn't... Me not good at math, so I didn't get an engineering degree or anything and did not go into patents. Sometimes it has applications of software, though for the code of a game, you can copyright it. You just send in code, and even if you're concerned about the code being partially sensitive, the copyright office is very good about how the way the sample's done and what you can submit, because you have to submit a copy of it. And it's nice that if you never physically have produced something, say you wanted to just copyright a YouTube video just because I'm not sure why. I mean, there are some reasons to do, but like I said, for the monetization reasons, unless somebody's putting out compilations and selling them in a flea market. But that's a nice thing with a trademark, because if they're using your name, you can just get them with the trademark. But you can submit digitally. Like, they have what's called the best copy rule. Like, if you produce a physical edition, you need the copy of the physical edition, or send them that. They want two copies for their own records, to store for the Library of Congress, which is why there are so many weird things sitting around there, because they were required to do that for a copyright registration. But one nice thing is now, since 1989, though the initial thing started around 1978, you don't have to worry about something created if you don't register it somehow becomes public domain. That's not possible. It's just not. But like I said, there are definite benefits to copywriting for the ability to sell for copyright, but also to, if you send a demand letter to say that you're going to ask for that too, so you have a good faith reason to ask for it. But those are sort of the two big things I initially want to talk about, is making sure you set the company up and you're protecting your IP, you're designing your logo, making sure you're doing it right. Like I said, library sources, work for hire agreements, make sure first of all you're doing it, the jurisdiction you're in recognizes it. Say if you subcontract out to someone in Europe, they have different rules on artist reversion rights than they do in the US. Other countries, it's not really a problem, but it's something to keep an eye out for. So just make sure when you're designing that logo to, do it on your own. As much as you want to, imitate something else, try and avoid it, mostly because, with a logo, it's not really people are going to search and stumble across it the same way if you said, I think the famous reference I've heard is that the reason Linkin Park was named Linkin Park was because they wanted to get right after in the CD stores, right after Limp Bizkit. I've heard that. I don't know if it's true. It's a very short-term plan to try and get ahead. Shit, I mean, late 90s, there's some bad music. It did peter out eventually. Thank God.
Linkin Park's still around, though.
No, but Limp Bizkit, but Fred Durst somewhere went away and hasn't come back. I think he was in a quasi remake of Shirley Jackson's The Library, Lottery. If anyone ever remembers the Simpson joke where all these people check out the book when they have the huge lottery going on, and it's like, unfortunately, the book doesn't offer anything about winning the lottery. It's a chilling tale of social conformity gone amok, and then Homer throws the book into a fireplace. That's somehow in the bedroom. That, love that gag. And then they finally had Marge say, why did we put a fireplace in there? But, that's one that you don't have to worry about now. Yes?
What if you wanted to incorporate religious symbols into your logo?
There are certain trademark rules about things they won't register. Actually, though, you can register offensive content now. There was a case going off the Slants who hadn't been able to register the name of their band for years because the trademark office, despite the fact that everyone in the band is Asian, considered it offensive. This also is why the Redskins are probably going to get their trademark back. I guess in theory now you could register, like, actually, no, that's, I'll save those ideas from a different panel, like really offensive things you can register. But I would, there are rules about things, there's still like decency rules, like they were, they refused at one time a certain condom registration because it was considered tasteless. Like, you, this is one of the reasons why, yeah, you can use LegalZoom, but they're not going to do a check and say, you know, I don't think your awesome-looking dildo design is going to get approved. I know that seems awful, but, well, I mean, if you make dildos, I mean, it makes sense. If you, a brand, a trademark is supposed to be something that a company or that the public will associate with your brand, and that's what you make. I mean, it makes more sense than having a cookie for your logo. But another thing I wanted to say about watching out for is the people you work with. Obviously, you probably work with a lot of friends who give time for free, for nothing. You really want to eventually formalize things, like especially if, like they're you're hosting them on a channel or they're hosting you on their channel. Have those things reduced to writing. I know it seems like, oh great, what a wonderful friend, but it saves you so much trouble and heartache later on. And you can always negotiate or change the deal later on by mutual consent. You just want to also make sure that the people you're employing, that you know what they're doing otherwise. Like, this guy could be great at video editing, but did anyone read about this weirdo acapella kid who like had like 500,000 views on his videos and some stupid Justin Bieber haircut, but they caught him at the border with child porn because he was getting his fans to send him naked pictures.
Yeah.
I don't know about that. I don't know because you know, I mean, the Mortal Kombat song Gun Acapella is cool and a couple of other ones, and then, you know, no, I don't need to see anything more of acapella in my life. Nothing against people who've been done that and all, but it's just you got to make sure the people you're working with are good and dependable. And if you have an agreement for them to do certain things, so they reduce it to a contract. It's an independent contract. You don't want them claiming any rights to your IP. And like I said, I know this sounds like a dick thing, but everyone does that. That's how it is. It's work for hire. I mean, if, let me think, if a major corporation gets to do it, you shouldn't feel guilty in the least about doing it. It's normal, and it's probably a better thing because it builds up their portfolio, and, you know, they'll actually get paid for it. Like a guaranteed amount, as opposed to, oh, when the YouTube money rolls in, we'll get you something, which is a nightmare waiting to happen, saying something like that. But like I said, you also want things that you could make sure that if you're working with other people, you're in control. It's one thing if you're appearing on their videos as a guest, but if they're appearing on yours, like say you have a series of them, that you can terminate that if they do something really gross in public, or, look, it's the internet. You can all use your imagination when people do on the internet. Yes. Really good question. You can have as many, obviously in theory you're formally restricted to whatever is in the description of the LLC, but you can be pretty broad with that. Actually, used to be super broad in Pennsylvania, but they actually stopped about 2 years ago because I remember when I filed for my wife, I used the term that they always used for any and all legal purposes.
They rejected it.
Yeah, and they rejected it, and I was just like, what the hell, because I was talking, then another attorney I knew got the same thing, so someone in Pennsylvania changed the rule for that. If you said, like, for production of entertainment products and related merchandise, and you get that group, then you can put whatever you want under it. I say if they're related, I think it makes sense. Though if you're, say, acquiring a new business, or if it's drastically different, it's a good idea to set up another one just because you don't want things commingled. Sometimes things can commingle, and that's fine because it makes sense, say, the revenue streams. But there's accounting reasons where it makes sense to keep them separate, just depending on the type of business it is. So it's really a fact-sensitive thing, but it's not necessarily bad to have it under. I wouldn't say, like, I wouldn't combine my legal practice using my wife's LLC because they're such different business, and also legal practice is so different anyway. But say we had two different things, I wouldn't run them from the same business. But if somehow we work for the same sort of product working together, that's different. But say, well, good for example, you have a card shop and your husband has a, or boyfriend or whatever, has a video game store. Don't run them out of the same thing. Have separate ones. But generally, if it's the same idea flowing from you, it should be fine. And the second question?
You're collaborating as friends, but you both have distinct LLCs. When you write up that legal contract, are you independently contracting as individuals, or is it?
As the LLC, yeah. It's a business relationship, because without it, you'd just be the same without the LLC. So you just, when you're filling in it, obviously, once again, it's variable and fact sensitive. You can put in who's a representative of, but the people, it's between two LLCs. There's, it's not like you're saying between person A and person B, it's LLC A and LLC B. Yes?
Hi. So I've been using the same company name since high school, a long time ago.
Yeah.
Use music videos, short films, music, but I, you know, all my stuff.
Right.
Only in the past 5 years have I started posting these things on YouTube, and then quickly found out there's another, there's like two other companies that use the same name. I've used it so long, it's such a small.
Well, in that case, well, it depends. If there are rules in trademark for prior use that can protect you, you have to see that the other companies have trademarks. If they don't, you know, you may want to trademark yours.
Okay.
Because they'll have, I mean, you won't be able to say, hi, you, I'm using this now. You're all liable for everything you did in the past. But it would limit them going forward. So it depends on the size and if it's just the LLC's name or if it's the actual, the business, that name they use, like the public face, you know, as opposed to like Swigglefish LLC or whatever thing you put for an LLC.
Do you need to have an LLC in order to file a trademark?
No, you can do it as an individual. I would just say, but once you set up the LLC, you're gonna wanna have to file for an assignment of the trademark to the LLC.
Okay.
Because it just makes more sense for this. And this is one of the other benefits of having trademarks. Say someone wants to buy your channel now, and if they do, guess what? You can offer them the trademarks, the LLC, the business structure. You want to be able to offer them all this formal stuff because there's value in the name. If the name's not trademarked and someone else could be using it, there's no general protection, the value of that sale can go down significantly because, I mean, why were they buying it? They're just buying the content, then they'll just buy the content that you have and forget the name and just incorporate it their own one. Yeah.
I was kind of worried about, like, if you're going to use like a music in a video and it's like already owned by someone else, is it like, do you have to like not monetize that video before you use it?
Well, I in the strict sense, you shouldn't probably monetize stuff with other things, and there are just fair use exceptions, and sometimes things don't get picked up on monetization, but that's kind of a roll of the dice. If it's done for like a specific thing that you could say is fair use exemption, you could probably get you could try and reverse the monetization of it. But like I said, try and use your own music you create or sound alike music. Anyone watch pro wrestling ever? Okay. You ever notice how certain things have music that sound like other things, but they're not actually? That sound alike music. I can't give you what the legal definition of between what infringement is and what sound alike is, but that's one example where, oh, that sounds like this song. But it's not, and we're not paying royalties or any licensing fees for it. So that's why I say, if you can create your own stuff or use library music, so much the better. I mean, look, I love Kung Fu movies, there's one where Darth Vader, like, this dude pops up in the room and they start playing the Imperial March from Star Wars. I have another one where it's the Ghostbusters theme and Rambo with a bunch of ninjas. I mean, I love that stuff, it's amazing. It's this neat little intersection of globalization, American pop culture, and local film production, and also re-exporting it back out to a global audience. But it's a problem. Yes?
One fun example of that, just as a side note, is Iron Chef used to have the soundtrack from Backdraft.
Yes.
And yeah, that never got aired here like that.
I seem to, in Japan, well, they, I remember Pride, when Pride FC was an MMA group that got bought by UFC, but they used to have stuff like these amazing packages before the fights, and they'd have one that was for Crow Cop versus Fedor Emelianenko, but that had the music from the Terminator. Now they licensed it, but there was a promo for for a New Japan event that had music from the Dark Knight in the background. Sometimes the licensing is valid in one country but not another. So that's one thing that maybe you can get permission from an artist, but if you ever want to export it to worldwide, make sure it deals for worldwide, or you have to geo-lock where the video can air, which is a nightmare. It's one thing if you're a major video distribution company, but if you're a local one, you don't want to geo-lock your videos. That's a horrible mess.
You mentioned, obviously you're talking a lot about branding, and you kind of mentioned about alluded to generic brand, you know, kind of being a lower tier. What can people do to ensure that they have sort of a strong, distinctive brand or trademark?
Well, one thing you do is engage as a work for hire, graphic designer, go over ideas, just think about, talk with well, don't talk with other people because then they'll claim they had a hand in it, but but if you contract out for people to do it, that's one way to do it. Or just think among yourself, you know, what's the way to set me apart as opposed to YouTube channel 45665 or something. Sorry, I just had the worst call this morning. But I think it's worth looking into. And I don't smoke, so it's not like I was just smoking a card on that side or something. Is to just visually think of ways you can improve it that are cost effective. Sometimes it's just you. Sometimes if you come up with a design and you contract it out to improve it, once again, as a work for hire, that's fine. Or you specifically sign an agreement that you're designing something for me, but it's done on a work for hire basis. Any ideas you come up with for me, my IP, and stay that way. So I think that's one way to improve, you know, the dreaded sort of, oh, generic, like, you're reusing some avatar that they released as a freebie thing on Steam when you bought, like, the deluxe edition or something. Like, say a picture of Geralt from The Witcher 3 or something. I think you have to agree with that.
Yeah, so Nintendo's gotten a bit of notoriety by flagging certain videos online for using their music.
Mm-hmm.
So I see a lot of YouTubers, you know, say, okay, I can't play the music from, you know, whatever game.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, I see just at this convention alone, there are all these bands that are not only using their songs and making money off of it, but using the images on the screen and all this. What's the difference?
Well, first, you're all going to learn the term selective enforcement. Things that appear visibly in one way are more notable to, say, Nintendo than others. Obviously, you know, I'm not commenting on anything that's going on here because I'm not aware of the arrangements that have been set up. So I don't want to imply one thing or the other. But the music could be under a licensing agreement. Same with the images, depending on how it is. They could clear that ahead of time. I mean, there have been video game concerts around the country. It's not that hard to think of. You contact them, or they may have something where if it's done as part of something they're participating as an umbrella, maybe they get a cut. Once again, this is not specific to this event, this is just in general. I mean, like I said, you walk around and see all the artwork and you're like, how in the hell is that? It's not. It's just they don't, I mean, they used to, back in the days, they'd have lawyers walk around Comic-Con and stuff, and there was a dude in New York who got busted by Toho for selling bootleg Godzilla movies. Well, the funny thing is that the story, as I'm told, the judge took a look at it and said, what the hell is this? And just dismissed it immediately. Even though it was totally valid and it was one thing. But they was like, oh, this is a criminal copyright. It was under New York. It wasn't federal. It was some weird New York law. And he's like, what the hell is this crap? And just dismissed the case. But they said that lawyers walking around at conventions and is not an unheard of thing in the past or even now. I mean, it's a lot easier to not to see things. But there's also more of an opening, I think, with a lot of companies, not necessarily Nintendo, but other ones, to, you know, work out agreements because the revenue stream is more important than shutting down someone's weird artwork. Now, obviously, one thing they do have control is the way the images look. I remember reading, there was an article saying when Overwatch came out, everyone, there apparently was a burgeoning porn segment of Overwatch fans in terms of the artwork. And I believe Blizzard's like, please stop doing that. Because, you know, Overwatch, it's a T-rated game, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So it can be marketed to people under the age of 17, and they really didn't want to see, like, that British chick and the gorilla and the thing with the tentacle. I haven't played the game, I've just seen, like, those ads that pop up with the British woman. So I guess that, you know, as a brand, because that's one of the important things, protecting your brand with fan art. Like, if you got a weird fan art who really loves hentai and tentacles and your stuff, you need to talk to her. I mean, maybe for some brands that's a plus, but depending on who you're marketing to, you don't want consumers being confused thinking, oh, why do they have all this tentacle porn associated with them? Obviously, if anyone saw that guy on Twitter from The Atlantic, he was taking screenshots of his computer, and apparently, from the way the article said, he had like all these hentai sites opened up, and he tried explaining away, saying no, he was having a discussion with his family about hentai.
Oh, I remember that.
Looking up for a friend. Yeah. That's why if you ever post screenshots, this actually is a good thing. You want to make sure your personal identifiers are blocked out if you're streaming. Now, I know some of the software out there does that, hides your friends' names, and if you're streaming with your friends, always make sure they know you're recording them. I mean, most should obviously know, but you're gonna have to eventually say, hey, you're on a monetized channel, you don't necessarily have any right to any of the funds, and you're also being recorded. I haven't seen anyone try and claim that video game streaming being recorded is a wiretapping or something, but you know, California's a weird state. They could always do that. But you want to make sure that, you know, if you're posting screenshots of something, even if you're doing normal stuff, always make sure you crop out your tags.
Yep.
Yeah.
Even if it's just like you're doing a video showing how something works on your computer, make sure there's no crap sitting on your desktop, even a file name. I mean, a lot of times people scan personal documents such as, you know, tax filings, things like that. You just want to make sure it's a bland, it looks like you walked into a Micro Center computer. And it even less than say, you know, there's no bloatware even on it, just like that screen is blank. And you just want to make sure, because, you know, it's your personal privacy. You don't necessarily want everything out there. I mean, maybe you don't have anything that you'd be concerned about, but maybe you just don't want people knowing. Say you have another game you like, but you don't want people bugging you to play it on your own. You just like playing it with a small circle of friends and not some weirdo. You know, that's one way to protect what you're playing too. But say you don't stream that one because there's no revenue for it. But you don't have to deal with like pissing off things like, oh, I want to play this with you. I'm like, Jesus Christ, man, I just want to conquer the world. Please leave me alone.
Yes. If I file a trademark for a name and I file a trademark for a logo, that's two separate trademarks.
Yes.
So if I design a character with that name and that logo, I don't have to file a trademark for that character, right?
Once you start using the business, you probably should, depending on how it's used. Obviously, you have the main logo, but if you have a secondary one you're still using too, like a character, I mean like Sonic's trademark, Mario's trademark. Though some of them actually are only TMs as opposed to registered, but I can give you a good example of one that absolutely is 100% registered, is Godzilla. Yeah. Toho does not screw around with people. Like I said, I had to deal with something where we had to have emails going back on the specific spelling of Destroyer and how many O's could be in it versus not. I mean, look, that's brand protection. As silly as it is, you don't want to dilute your thing. I mean, it's absolutely silly because it's like ridiculous going back and forth, but it made sense and they were polite about it, so it wasn't a big deal. But, you know, you want to make sure those things are taken care of.
But could I say that it's like that character itself is like covered under that?
You could put a TM there and you could say it's a trademark of yours. It's an unregistered trademark, but it's still something you intend that you view as your IP. Though I would say once you get the money to do it, just do it. As long as it makes sense from a revenue point of view and they're using it enough. I mean, if something just goes foul and you don't use it, I mean, maybe someone will have a weird use for it 10 years down the road, but it's the internet.
So, like, if I design a logo and I just decide to draw a whole circle with a TM in it, is that
no, it would just be a TM. The R of the circle is only for registered trademarks. Yeah. You can't do that without registering it first.
What are the penalties for using an R?
Oh, God. One is that it's not treated as a trademark. It's not registered. There are, like, common law trademark claims, but you don't get any of the benefits of it. And it's somewhat considered, not like in a criminal sense fraud, but like if you start using it before you ever registered, somebody could apply to cancel the trademark because you're not allowed to do that before.
I have a YouTube channel where I do artwork. I draw stuff. Mm-hmm. So I came up with a name for the channel, and I didn't do any of the stuff that we're talking about.
Right.
So you would say I should trademark the name that I create, that I...
that you do your stuff under, yes.
Right, for text, that's the text part of it. And then if I create my own logo for it, I gotta make sure the font isn't something that is... You know,
right, you wanna make sure you're using, like, you're creating your own thing, but you're not using something that says registered. Because I know there are things like registered fonts.
Right, right.
And I seem to recall there was something with a science issue, or something like... I forget it, but there is a registered font that I know.
But last question.
Yeah.
Say I draw characters that are already like copywritten characters, you know what I mean? Now, how does that go? Like, say I create artwork, I decide, hey, I'm gonna put it on a t-shirt, right? I'm gonna start selling it as my artwork, but it's...
You're absolutely at risk of getting sued by them. Small scale things you're doing for friends or limited stuff, like you're just sitting there at the time, but if you start selling stuff, like you start putting Mario on a bunch of things, you're gonna get something from Tokyo sent to you, probably. Or Seattle, probably. Yes?
Creating free content and your YouTube channel is non-monetized and the only income you might receive is in the form of a donation.
Yeah.
Do you still need an LLC?
Yeah, because once again, you're still personally liable. Just because you don't make money off something doesn't mean someone can't sue you for it. That's the only thing to remember is you could have a total loss of everything, And someone can still sue, win, and collect all three of them. And especially if you're doing nonprofits, like you should have the nonprofit LLC set up.
Yep. So
okay, so if I do draw the little letters TM in my logo, is it now a trademark without me having to do anything?
No, it just shows that you consider it a trademark.
Consider it a trademark.
That you put people on it, so it's part of your IP, but yeah, it doesn't have any legal anything. It's just you put the TM there.
Okay, so
but you're allowed to also use it while you're registering too. Like, until you get the certificate, you cannot put the R in the circle. And I think we're got about 5 minutes left, so just a few more questions.
Yeah. On YouTube, what is like a very basic but effective way of handling a copyright strike?
Depends on the nature of the claim. If it's something you can prove is totally wrong, go for it. But I mean, keep in mind it doesn't operate under a legal system. It operates under whatever the hell YouTube wants to do. Obviously, they're governed by general laws in the sense of being a business. But if they want to administer a copyright way in the most draconian way possible and say, like, we don't care, that's it. Now, if you can provide them with evidence, because I've had stuff of mine claimed a bunch of times. Some jackass, actually, I put up a clip of Turkish Star where someone claimed the rights on that. And I was like, first of all, I was using a legal presentation. It was a short excerpt. And I was like, you got some real gall trying to claim copyright in a movie that literally exists because of total copyright. And they released it. So it's something, it really depends on the situation. And also just who's operating the thing at YouTube. It could be the compassionate guy who cares about fair use. There could be the dude that's a subcontractor who hates you. Hates everything around him, and can't get paid, and it's going to just strike you for the hell of it. Yes.
So I operate Content ID for ScreenWave Media, and if I see when I look in the interface, I see a bar graph, and I see the whole video. And if you make a video, and 99% of your video is using our music, I won't release the claim. But if I'm looking at it, and it's a little chunk, like you made an hour-long live stream and then you played our music at the very end for a second, I'll release it. I'll usually release it. Also, if something has like 7 views on it, I'll usually release it, but if it has 1 million views on it,
yeah.
I won't.
There are some insanely huge views, and they're all, like I was talking about, they're first of all, they'll degrade the image, they'll chop it in half. Those are the ones you may actually want to consider just removal because it makes your product look like crap. And also you're going to probably make someone blind from viewing it. Yes.
So I do game plan videos.
Mm-hmm.
Am I at risk for getting sued for like playing and streaming like a game?
Well, truthfully, the weird thing is there haven't really been any legal cases about Let's Play videos. Funny enough, there was some Sony attempted to trademark it, and after a bunch of people complained about it, they dropped it. But it's really a gray area. In theory, it is their intellectual property, but then again, you're playing it, so maybe it's a transformative use.
Yeah, you made the game.
Yeah, right.
And probably story plot that doesn't want to spoil anything.
Right, that's why you'll see a lot of things that are taken down before the game comes out, that if they're uploaded after the game comes out, no one cares. It really depends on the company. As we know, Nintendo can be special. Other companies don't care. They consider free advertising. I know Paradox Development Studios love people streaming their games. They've even set their software up where they had some band contribute music for it, but you can disable it because they even put a warning saying, if you're streaming this, this isn't granted in it, but everything else is. They even have their lawyers say, draw something up because there are some weird content pickups. And they said, you can always stream this. This is fine under these conditions. And it really depends. I don't see you streaming games. You know, I'm going to say this, and then some weird, crazy game studio is going to pop up, like Derek Smart or something. And you'll be fine. I mean, my official legal channel has a staggering 8 views of me playing Stellaris on the PC. And I don't live in fear. Yes.
Create original music for like a game store or something like that. How is that get copyrighted? Just when you register your game and all of it?
Well, you're registering the music composition or you're registering the sound elements or the actual, like the sound recording.
You can register the music composition and then use it in your own. You can grant it yourself to use in your game, right?
Right. You can, usually you register as part of like the whole product as a whole, but since it's a huge business of selling soundtracks, you absolutely should register it separately too. Copyright, the nice thing about copyright, it's cheap. It's $35 to $55 to do online, depending on the type. If you're releasing a major product, there's no excuse not to do it. I mean, unless you, somebody didn't tell you to do it, that's the only thing I'm saying, if somebody didn't tell you to do it, and like, you have, I mean, I don't care what you've made, I mean, maybe there's some weird Japanese visual novel that's made like only $5 on Steam, but everything at least makes some money on Steam and justify copyrighting it.
What about movie scripts? Like, once you, you finish your script...
You can copyright the script separately.
Right, or what would be better, the copyright or the registered copyright?
You should copyright through the WGA.
Yeah, the WGA is one method.
That was another question I had about the WGA.
The WGA thing's nice for arbitration matters, but they ain't the copyright office, so you can do both.
Okay.
Especially if you want to sell the script around.
Right.
It's just as a way to protect you from that. I know the WGA, like I said, it's good for arbitration, but like they're not the U.S. government.
Right.
There's also like the old man's copyright, where just basically you just mail the thing to yourself, but like it's an actual stamp, like.
Yeah, but it's really fallen out of favor for doing that. And like I said, these days, set aside like 2 hours of your job or whatever you're doing to just say this is going to the copyright, just forget about it. It's the best way to do that. Trademark's a lot more money than I understand it, but if you're, you know, putting a lot of time into a script, you know, that's something I would say concrete. But I think we've run out of time now. I want to thank everyone for this panel. And if you're interested in my legal service, I have some business cards up here, but otherwise have a great final day at 2 Main Games.